I always give a three-lap running period as long as it's daylight here, because it's not that critical to have the lights on. But in the night, they should definitely get it fixed immediately for safety.
Yes, this was this rule was put in to ensure that the DT cars can easily see the LMP cars coming up from behind. So actually, the lights on rule is not for the DT cars, but it just it's just for all cars in the field. But it's actually meant to make it easier for the DT cars to see the LMP cars.
But also the new new-ish change to the car pack, meaning that GT cars have yellow headlamps and LMP white, means that a damaged LMP or slow-moving LMP can easily spot whether it's a GT or LMP coming up behind just from the color of the headlamps.
Yes, I think that was a pretty good change to these cars, and a pretty good change to the rules. Just getting a notice here from Lasse that he is going to stay in the car.
Alright, he has been doing good, so as long as he's awake, alive and kicking, then I guess that's a good thing.
I think he is very kicking indeed, and as we see here, the kitted DK car is actually coming up to unlap themselves from the FTC, the leading FTC LMP car, so this will be exciting. Flashing his headlights to say, move out of the way.
Indeed. Though he still has four laps to go before he's caught up.
And a very experienced move by the FTC car to just let him by and not risk ruining his race for the remaining 7.5 hours. So this is, if you may say, there is any downsides to endurance racing, because of course we get to see a lot of overtakings and cars being at different paces. We will always see exciting situations, but if you are the leading car and you have a huge gap to second place, of course you will slow down and set a pace that you'll be more sure to not make mistakes and finish the race. So of course you will not be racing the second place car for an unlapping. So well, that's just how endurance racing is.
Yeah, if we can have a look at Kitty DK again, they're actually chasing Bass right now quite closely.
Ah, yes, and as I was mentioned, these two cars are actually matching lap times very closely at the moment.
And we have the FTC cars right on their tail as well, so yeah, even though mathematically it might not be close, then it definitely looks close on TV and is close for the racers out there in the seat.
Yes, and this is another situation, because actually the Bass car is the car that's behind here. So he will want to do everything within the rules to have the Team Kitty DK car stay behind.
Exactly.
And side by side across the finish line here, start finish line. He's looking good. And I think the Bass car just overshot his turn in there and gave up another meter or two. It's very difficult here on Sebring. There are so many driving lines in these corners. You can't really talk of an ideal line. you can take the corners in so many ways, so it's really good for overtaking maneuvers.
Oh!
I bet that was supposed to happen.
Yeah, that's really a shame. I was hoping to see those three keep racing for hours.
Well, maybe maybe the Bass car is just too fast for him to hang on to.
I'm sure it is, because they were hanging on because Bass had recently been to the pits, but now Bass is two or three laps into a stint, and yeah, that means that his tires and everything will be optimal now, so now's his time to really push it.
And I know that this team KD car is run by Nikolaj Pedersen, who's quite new to these LMP cars, and I know from the DGTL session that he just started racing the Aston Martin DBR1-2, and he was really satisfied with that car because it doesn't have this low rev torque kick of the Audi. But here on the track they tested the Audi, and they were able to do much better lap times, so according to the rules you can change the car and still get points for the championship, so they changed to the Audi. And he's driving with a friend of his he just also picked up sim racing again, so they are not that experienced, and this may be a sign of inexperience trying too hard to hang on to faster cars when they pass. It's something we see often by new guys.
Yeah, but having said that, then them hanging on to the second place quite strongly now is definitely impressive, and it doesn't take that much of trouble for FTZ for Team Kitty to actually be first.
No, the LMP cars are much more sensitive to damage, and they'll be prone to having bigger accidents and taking longer pit stops to repair. So even though it looks... Also, if you look at the lap times, a gap of five laps in an LMP class can be compared to only a gap of two laps in a GT car. So because they are faster and because of this more accident-prone factor.
Sure, the risk of actually exiting the race because of a big crash or something is also bigger in LMP because of the faster speeds and more sensitive cars and so on, and especially if we get rain, then all bets are off.
Yes, of course. And maybe also this is worth noticing, these cars that we're using here are modified from the original GTR2 cars. Of course, this is an entirely un-GTR2 or not original car to GTR2, but it's still been changed in the way that damage does not affect the engine or the T-bones of the wheels, so that or the wishbones of the wheels, so you can't actually lose wheels and you can't damage the engine from impact, but you can still bend the suspension severely.
Yeah, and also from crash testing, I've noticed that if you hit a wall and you're in like a gravel pit, severe suspension damage can cause the car to just hang on its belly as if you got stuck in deep snow or something. So even though it might be very hard to destroy the car, it's quite possible to damage it in a way that you wouldn't be able to get to the pits, or that it would take maybe 10, 15, 20 minutes to get there.
Yes, of course. And by then the car will likely have overheated and the engine will be destroyed from internal damage, or how you would put it.
That's actually what we saw at this year's 24-hour Le Mans race. I think it was the FTZ car that actually spun out on the first lap and got stuck in a sand pit and was trying for 30, 40 minutes or something to get loose, and eventually... the engine couldn't take all those revs and standing still anymore.
Well, they were at a point where they started to damage the engine so badly. It didn't actually burn out, but it was damaged so badly that if they got out of the gravel pits, they would not be able to finish the race.
Right.
So no matter how nice they would have driven the car, or how easy they would have been on it, after that they wouldn't have been able to finish the race. So yeah, they gave up.
Exactly. The cars here are tuned to be able to last a bit longer than the race if you drive them normally. And if you drive them hardly, they can last anything from a normal race distance to maybe only a few minutes or a few hours. It kind of, the more you overheat or over rev the engine, the wear will increase logarithmically. So you can get extreme wear by just one downshifting too early or something like that. So if you have taken 75% of your engine lifetime out on the first lap, there's basically no way you can finish, even if you idle it along.
Yes, that's just how that is put together. That's
it's like having an oil leak in a normal engine. No matter how careful you drive, it won't last you a whole day.
Exactly. But let's hope that these FTC guys have learned a lesson and will stay on track this time. It surely looks as if that's the case, yeah. They just did a new fastest lap for their car.
Oh yeah, 148.2, that's very good. Or 0.1 actually, 148.1.
Yes, it's the fastest lap for this session, but it's not actually the fastest lap they've done in the race. That's a 148.143. So they're still, they have still earlier been a half of a tenth of a second faster.
And just to put that in perspective, the best laps of Team Bass was about a second and a half faster. But they're not going that fast right now. So actually FTZ is looking very, very strong.
At the moment the FTC car is actually the fastest, I think, of the Team KDDK is still the fastest at the moment, the fastest LMP car on track. And the Bass car is slowing right down from a pace that was around 146 lap times to 149s. They may just have, I think they've just had a pit stop and a change of driver. It also looks like Stenek has just had a pit stop. Team Ezeon car, though withdrawn from the race, is still keeping ninth place overall.
Actually, I just got some insider information from Henrik, the driver of the Bass car, on why they are kind of a bit off pace compared to their extreme pace earlier. It's actually to do with their strategy. They are double stinting their tires right now. And seeing as they're that much behind as they are trying to do some testing on the car to see what kind of strategies will work and won't work. But this is a step in that, and of course it probably can't hurt their chances.
No, I was just thinking that's quite a smart move, I think, because they may discover things here that can gain them even more lap time. And of course, if they can't catch up, it does not really matter because they are still very much behind.
Exactly, and if they can gain the knowledge today, they'll need to win the 24-hour race, then that'd be amazing. And there's no better test than a really long endurance race. It doesn't compare to training on your own.
No, and you'll get the proper test of your equipment here too. I know, of course, a lot of cars have been disconnecting from the race because of internet-related issues. But still, there's so much more in a race frame computer that can go wrong. So driving these long races is really the best possible test of all your equipment too.
Right now, 10-man project is about to lap our German friends.
Yes, let's have a look.
That'll put them 3 laps ahead.
Oh, I don't think he expected to catch up with the Corvette in the exit of that corner, because he just had to evade to the inside, and that of course gave the team calling racing car an advantage on the straight, but unable to pursue his advantage, the 10-man project car stays in front of this 3-car pack.
And we see the Germans are pitting in now. But Team Colling is definitely going to stay on the 10-man project car hard, and they'll be going 101%, I'm sure.
It will be a wise thing for them to do, to now see if they can catch up, but stay out of trouble, just trying to keep the same pace and not make any mistakes.
10-man project is 2 laps ahead of Colling 3 behind them. So Colling 3 getting ahead would be a big thing for them, for sure. That'd put them within more of a reach than they are now.
Yes, but I think at the moment it looks like the Formula Yamaha car will have to do something stupid to lose the first place, because he has actually just put in the fastest lap of the race for that car. So it doesn't look like, even though the former Yamaha car is in front, it doesn't look like Lasse is slowing down or taking it easy in any way.
Not at all, no, not at all. I think annoyingly it just makes him even more hungry to be ahead. Annoyingly for his competition, of course. Not for you guys.
Well, it definitely makes it hard for any of the other cars to, let alone just keep up with the performance of the Lister Storm car, because with the setup we have at the moment, we can do lap times that is relatively the same as the other GT cars, and on top of that we are doing 3 laps more on every tank of gas. So
Steen has spun out.
There he is.
And he's back on track behind the Germans now. They just overtook him as he spun out.
And I think also this time around the German guys are really picking up the pace now. I noticed also when I was driving behind them before the last safety car period that they were actually in a quite fast pace. It's in the beginning these guys were all green to endurance sim racing, and they didn't really have that fast a pace. But that has definitely changed now, as we see.
Actually, talking to Frank, one of the German drivers, what I heard was that they had been meeting up and driving together against AI drivers. But now they're definitely getting some experience with real racing, and he told me they got a really good dark room and good setup for their huge, ambitious projector setup. So they have an enormous screen to race on and so on. And they're really nice, happy, friendly guys who just love this stuff.
As is the rest of the teams, I know we know most of the drivers from the GTR 24H event.
Yeah, and I think I can say that everyone here is here to have fun, and that's what's going on.
Yes, fun is primary, positions is actually secondary.
That's one of the drivers of the lead car.
Yeah, I know. Perhaps that's why Lasse is just keeps pushing the car, even though we are leading the GT class, because it's just more fun that way.
And also easier to focus, I found. If you get too far ahead and you get too focused on driving safely and slowly, you kind of get out of the rhythm. Driving a race car, it seems most natural to be doing your best all the time.
Yes, and it focuses your thought process, so you don't start thinking about weird other stuff than just keeping the car on track. And that's of course a good thing to be focused.
Exactly.
Like most other sports, a lot of what's really going on and what you really need is a focused mind. Much like other concentration sports. I've also been talking to one of my friends who is an avid triathlon runner, and of course you think that when you're running these kind of physical events and running a marathon, you would think that having good physics and being strong is important, but actually equally as important is also to keep focus and keep focusing on doing your best and keeping the right pace. Actually, it is a problem for people also in these kind of physical sports to lose concentration, lose attention on what you're actually doing right now.
That sounds quite reasonable. I'm gonna try to get Henrik Højer from the BAS car in here.
Yes, that would be interesting to hear from him what they are going to try to do now.
Yeah, I think we'll have him here in a few moments. It'll be interesting to hear what they are working on right now, and yeah, especially how they're gonna catch up those 60 or so laps.
That was actually a situation here where one of the LFP cars lost the rear end grip trying to overtake inside standing here. The LFC car lost the rear end. He was lucky enough to be T-boned by the German SH car.
Culling 3 is now stuck between Bass and Hello Kitty, I almost said. Oh! There was some collision between Kitty and Culling.
Of course, it's not a nice thing to do to push the GT cars, but sometimes in an LFP car, when you can't overtake on the straights, inexperienced drivers will get so frustrated that they sometimes get to push the GT cars around.
And Henrik Højer has just joined the TeamSpeak channel now. He's one of the drivers from the BAS Epsilon team.
They are not driving with their lights on.
2 seconds. I'll just make sure that happens. 2 seconds.
And they're on.
Well,
good.
Welcome, Henrik.
Thank you, and good afternoon to everybody on the live stream. So it hasn't really been the greatest of races right now for us. With our internet connection, that was cut up pretty early. But right now, we're just testing out equipment and strategies to see what works and what doesn't work, really. It's a big testing session for us right now.
Yes, of course you would view it as a big testing session or a long testing session. But could you fill us in on some of the details that you are trying to test at the moment?
At the moment, we're trying to double stint tires, see where it works. We also have another type of brake pedal, which I'm not used to. So that's also one of the things we are testing out right now, whether it's working and how it's working on us as individual drivers.
Yes, because usually you used to drive with the paddles, the Logitech G25 paddles,
yes,
as I remember, right?
Yes, that's true. And right now we're driving the G25 wheel and the Fanatec paddles. I'm not quite sure which one it is, but it's definitely different to drive with, and it takes some getting used to.
Brake pedals, right?
Yes, I have lots of brake pedals, and that's something I'm definitely not used to.
But it's a load cell brake pedal, this one, right?
Yes, it is. That's also a difficult thing for me to use, because I don't have a driving license, so I don't know exactly how it works with using both pressure as in distance and force to brake the car. So.
Of course, this is different to your usual potential meter brakes, where you apply the brakes according to a position of the brake pedal.
Yes, exactly.
This is actually applied by pressure, so the brake pedal won't really move that much, and the more pressure you put onto the brake pedal, the harder it will brake. So that's of course a big difference from what you guys are used to.
Yes, I mean just seeing how it works and you know stuff like that. But anyway, it's just a big test session for us right now. If we can get maybe holding 5 or 6 laps again or something like that, I would say it's a great success at this point, maybe even more. But let's see, it's a long race, a long test session if you want for our case. So.
Well, from what we've seen so far before, Before you change the brake to the new brake pedals, you've been doing lap times that are it's 1.5 second faster than any of the other LMP cars. So this looks promising for your participation in this year's DTR 24H event.
And it doesn't look also bad. Actually, I haven't been out driving yet, so but it doesn't look too bad. Because of the server restarts, actually I didn't drive yet. I'll be next in the car, so...
What we just saw in the background was the 10-man project overtaking Steen. So they actually now have caught up with what they lost to him, at least, in the last server restart that was caused by them. And that puts them third in the GT class. In front of them is a former Yamaha first, and Bernie Racing second.
And they are just 2 laps, and I think about 500-700 meters behind the team Bernie Racing Ferrari.
Exactly, so we have Yeah, top 4 in GT within 2 to 3 laps. That's not too big of a spread, and yeah, I guess they can all win still.
Definitely, definitely. This has become a race of the least incidents or least accidents at the moment. Perhaps not as much on pace, because these cars match each other so so closely on pace. And in about an hour or so, the race will go into a new phase when the lights start to fade as we get into the twilight zone before it gets completely dark. I would expect it to be pretty much completely dark at around 6 o'clock, perhaps a little bit later. That will, of course, also be a new situation for some of the drivers in this race, particularly the Team KDK drivers. And as we saw in the GTR 24, it will be a challenge to the German guys from the Carbixtrunk team, as they are racing on a very big projection screen, which does not do very well with the dark conditions.
Yeah, Funk did ensure me that they made a very, very dark room this time. I think it's quite critical to them in night racing. If they have just a little bit of light, the projector gets too hard to see stuff on, so they really need to know the track.
Yes, and of course a projector can give quite a strong light effect, but it has problems with the contrast, so projecting dark or completely dark areas is actually a problem for the projector, and that is actually contrary to what you may think, that it can't really show how dark it is. Actually is the problem, because the differences between colors seem to fade entirely away and the screen just looks gray instead of light and dark.
Yeah, so definitely a disadvantage there, but I'm sure the level of immersion must be quite good with that enormous screen and a completely dark room where there's nothing but you, the racing seat and the windshield.
Yes, that seems like the right way to go, but personally I'm more for the triple screen solutions, also because you could just have three screens a little bit closer to your steering wheel. And apart from problems with GTR2 itself and the triple screen solution, it actually is very immersive in other games. So I'd definitely recommend it to any sim racer to use a triple screen race rig. It will give you advantages and a much more intense and immersive feel of the car. And let's hope that we get these issues fixed this coming year. As we know, R-Factor 2 and GTR 3 is right on the steps to be released, which will definitely be a good thing for the entire sim racing community, no matter where you are, if your preferences lie with R-Factor or Simbin's GTR series.
Yeah, it's going to be exciting which one of those will be best suited for our 12 and 24 races, where we need like the most realistic light changes and weather changes, and also things like being able to rejoin during the race would be nice to have. So yeah, definitely looking forward to seeing which will be the strongest for our format.
Well, definitely, as we are looking at the 10-man project here, they would have benefited hugely from being able to join the race again immediately after having a disconnection. And of course, the Black Arrow Simsport team that lost something like 40 laps due to a disconnection. Of course, this situation would have been completely different if they could have just joined the race session again right after they've been or had their disconnections.
For sure, being able to just rejoin and then start from the pits with maybe a small penalty that would be natural from restarting your computer or whatever, that would be a nice addition.
Yes, and also as it is with R Factor and the online driver changes, where you can have an online race where you can actually sit at your own race frame and hand over the car to a guy in New Zealand or America if you want to do that. That's also a huge improvement over having to be at the same physical place. Not saying that it's a bad thing, but is kind of a hindrance to creating really big online events. Of course, most of the time, all participating drivers would like to see as many cars on the track as possible, because that's just part of what makes it so much more fun to constantly have someone that you're fighting with.
Sure thing. I think right now it's actually only one team who doesn't really have anyone to fight with, and that's Henrik's team, Bash, that we just talked to. Everyone else is more or less within reach of other cars.
Yes, if we say that a serious accident can cost you two laps and a disconnection will cost you about four laps, then yes, for sure, everyone in the GT class is still in contention for the win.
And even in LMP, it's a five-lap gap, so one unlucky disconnect from the leader car would put the first and second cars, FTZ and Team Kitty, put them about equal.
Yes, it's a good. And we also have to remember that the Team Kitty car, when on track, is actually going faster than the FTZ car. So the situation right now is the Team Kitty car may well catch up with the FTC car if they can just step down on their small incidents, because that's what's put them where they are now. It's small incidents touching the barrier here and there and having to go into the pits to repair headlights or repair aero damage. So if they can minimize damage and incidents from now on, they may very well catch up with the FTC car.
That can definitely gain them a lot, so yeah, that's what they really need to do. And actually, hearing from Henrik that his friend Carsten had been driving the Bass car full-time since we started, actually means we have two drivers now that have been going on their own for 5 hours, except of course Carsten was out of the race for quite a few laps, but still, him and Steen just keeping on. Going on is quite impressive.
Yes, it is. I don't know if Steen aims to complete the entire race by himself, but that would definitely be a first for me. From what I've ever heard, I've never heard of anyone completing a race without any incidents for 12 hours.
I'd say even if he does it on his own with a 15-minute break in the middle or something, it's still very extreme, I say.
Well, I will just be away for a few seconds. I'll have to check up with the team because it looks like I'll be going into the car in the very near future.
Yeah, well, good luck, Peter.
And just quickly here, we have just received news that the Black Arrow SimSport team has been disconnected from the server again. Of course, this is not their first disconnection, so there won't be a safety car period this time. So too bad, as Henrik was just telling us that they were starting to test things on the car. And now they seem to be completely out of the race now. If there's not another restart, but of course another safety car period would have to be triggered by some of the car that has. Cars that have not had any problems yet, so that would have to come from the Formula Yamaha team, or as I remember, Team Colling Racing has not had any incidents either. Apart from that, I think every other team has had a disconnection, or perhaps FTC has not had any disconnections yet. So three cars at the moment can cause a safety car, and of course that would be what Henrik and Carsten and the Black Arrow SimSport team will have to hope for.
I think you're right with that the FTC car haven't had any server restart.
Oh, you're still with us, Henrik?
Yes.
So what happened? Just
I wasn't driving, so he's sitting upstairs and I'm downstairs, so I don't know what happened. I just assume it's the same problem we had the last times.
We just came out
on the lobby. According to Carsten, that's never happened before on his PC or his network, so, yeah, bad logs.
Yes, definitely, bad luck, Henrik, and, I think I can speak for everyone when I say that my thoughts and everyone else's thoughts here in the commentary channel are with you. I know how horrible it is to be in a situation where you can't we can't do anything to fight for your position.
Well, that's just another excuse for drinking some beer, I guess.
It may be. I wish you guys the best, and hopefully we will see another race restart or another safety car period in the near future, so that you guys can join back in the race.
Yeah, and hope we can watch your beginning to drive.
And we can watch your, of course, gasoline-powered car put it to the diesel Audis once again.
A great race, guys. It was very funny. And thanks for the space for GT cars. And yeah, a shame, but that's racing.
Yeah, good effort, Carsten. That's really a lot of hours you put in there.
Well, actually, I was thinking about taking a stint more, but well, then, yeah, you struck out again, luck or unluck.
So you weren't getting tired after 5 hours of racing, more or less?
We're not giving up yet.
No.
That's the spirit.
Yeah, I'm still doing it. I haven't been driving yet, so I might start next time out. So I might hold back on the BS and wait for the next server restart.
That sounds reasonable, for sure.
At least something, we got the fastest step of the race, as far as I can see in on blind timing, so that all was to say.
Yeah, you did a very impressive time of 1:46.465. So if that was your ambition, very well done.
Well, we're not putting our ambitions all too high, so
is your current car and driver configuration something you expect to use at the 24-hour race?
You never know.
Actually, maybe. We don't know. It might be a petrol car for sure, but it's all down to the mathematics here, whether it's possible. This car, well, it is fast, but I think on the miles it's using a little too much fuel for being very competitive. I think when I tested here before the 24-hour race with Epson, I only got like 11 laps or something out of it, 10 or 11 laps.
In this race, the miles hasn't been all that bad. I think it was, what, three and a half laps behind the diesel cars?
Yeah.
How much?
Our fuel. Yeah, well, on one tank of fuel, we're about 4 laps or something, using that more. Oh, and that earlier, so.
In one lap, they were 2.5 to 3 seconds fast.
So.
Oh, I'll just be rejoining here for a few seconds to fill you in on something here. I think it may be a great idea if people watching out there could turn their attention to perhaps Facebook and the GTR24H page, where they will then be able to ask questions to the commentaries sitting here as we see the FTC car entering the pits. You can find it at facebook.com/GTR24H. That is GTR24H.
Yeah, we'll be sure to keep an eye on the page and see if we can answer any questions that come up there. What we are seeing here is the race leader, FTZ car. It is right now still 4 laps ahead. It has been that way for a long time. Behind them we have Team Kitty DK, and then comes the GT cars, Formula Yamaha, Bernie Racing, Stein Stenica, 10-man project, Team Culling 3, Kaubex Strunk, German guys, and yeah, and that's it. Right now it seems the race has hit a quiet period where everyone has found the pace they can go at in a stable way, so everyone's just rolling up the laps without much incident or anything. I think it might be the quiet before the storm. Right now everything's stable with some space between the cars, and they're just rolling up the laps, and I think once it starts to get dark and people get perhaps a little bit tired, we might see some more action. But right now everything's kind of just a smooth ride for everyone, it seems. And I am aware that the camera has been stuck on the FTZ car for some time now. I don't have an ability to change the camera myself, so we'll have to wait for one of the other commentators to join in before we can see someone else. But I'll for sure keep an eye on the rest of the field and keep you posted if something interesting happens. And as Peter mentioned earlier, if you have any questions for the commentators, please write them at the GTR24H Facebook group as GTR24H. Just write your any questions you may have about the race, about our setup, our rules, and so on. And we'll try to get back to you as soon as possible.
And about our yearly 24-hour event in here in Denmark.
For sure, this 12-hour race is kind of a spin-off from the 24-hour race, and I think most of the guys here are using this as a very intense form of practice for the big race. So I think it's time for the race control to have a short break, and maybe you can take the mic for a short moment.
Yeah, I'll just have a look at the things.
Okay, great, Chris. I'll talk to you guys later.
And that was our race leader, Alex Rees, who just went for a short break. He's been sitting here all day too, so and not similar to the rest of us, he haven't had a break until now. Currently in the picture we have our race leader, the FTC Audi R15.